man DRES from Blacksheep in the building, representing Flushing, representing hip hop around the world, y'all. You see on the projection from the early 80s from this area with some of the original pioneers, and you can see the DJ Grand Wizard and me, the Turnout Brothers, DJ Wizards here. But these were the flyers that, and to see the party only cost $2. How about that? Back in the days. This is early hip hop right here. Big up to my man Ron Lawrence for donating this to Queens Library for this event. This is from his archives, his collection. And DJ Ron Lawrence is a hip hop pioneer and lives out of state. He's not here with us today, but he sent these in for us to have for the library and for this event. Did I leave your mind when I was gone? 1, 2. If you over 40 up in here, make some noise right now. I'ma just leave it at that, alright? If you're under 30, make some noise up in here right now. Alright, I like that, I like that, I like that. So, what I'm going to do, right now is I'm going to bring up some of the pioneers that are here that are part of the photo exhibit or will be part of the photo exhibit. And let me just tell you a little bit about that. Is that it will be an ongoing thing. Like, this is not the first time. This is the fourth one, right, Kim? This is the fourth one? This is the fourth one that we've done. We started out in Jamaica, Queens. So I want to have all the guys from Southside and Jamaica, Queens come on up. That's where we started this whole idea from. And come on up. And the guys from Queensbridge, we did it in Queensbridge. St. Albans, come on up. All the pioneers that are part of the photo exhibit. If you're not part of the photo exhibit yet, you come on up and introduce yourself. And then we want to have East Elmhurst, Corona, and Flushing, and Corona, come on up here. Astoria, come on up here and just talk about what's going on. So that you know that this is a collective of individuals. They didn't make records, well, some did, but they were a very important part of what this whole thing was about. So I'm going to let them start to introduce themselves, and then I'm going to bring up our guest speaker, our guest host, Wiz. And we're going to introduce our guest speaker, and then we're going to get back to some music so you can learn a little bit about Queens hip-hop, all right? If you love Queens hip-hop, make some noise up in there. If you love hip-hop in general, make some noise in general, man. All right, so come on over here, Devon. You can start it off.
What's up, y'all? How y'all doing? Y'all feeling good out there?
Yes!
Y'all know hip-hop really started in each borough. Yeah, it started in each borough. Nobody, because we all stayed around in our own circle, and it was something that was really developed over a period of time. That's how I see it. There are some people that was doing a lot of different things, but everybody had their own swing on it. I think in Jamaica, South Jamaica, I could say that the proven ground was Fantasia, Les Chalet, ISA, Encore, you know, a lot of clubs out there, a lot of rap artists that really made it big and did records, they came there. You know, it was all about Queens. We had the sound system. You know, it all started with the DJs first in the parks. 127, Bootyland, New Sounds. You know, I think that Infinity Machine, the group that I was with, was inspired by them. Goody heard, Michael Goody, he heard their sound system and he wanted to duplicate them and be much bigger than New Sounds, because New Sounds was, to us, was Kings. You know, and then you had King Charles, you had Vernon, you had these cats from out here in East Elmhurst that was doing their thing. And like I said, over a period of time, it became hip-hop, but it was just coming to the park, seeing Vernon cut with a cast on and all that craziness, you know. I mean, it was good. We had fun. And then it turns into other things. But I don't think it was no set birth record of it, because it was always in us. Everybody was looking for a special break in a record and play it back, because that's what made somebody dance. And then you had people that was get on the mic and say a couple of things, and it just developed from there, I think. I think it evolved from, you know, there. But I love hip hop, you know, I live hip hop. And I just, it's just me. That's just what I do, you know. Yes, my name's DJ Devon.
Yeah.
This is my brother, Tony Moore, UG, Cypher Sound. I started out with them in the early part of the 70s. All right? So I'm going to give the mic to him and let him say something. Peace, y'all.
Okay. Cypher Sounds, DJ Understanding.
Supreme Sounds, DJ Casino.
Baby J, Woodside.
DJ Ken Lou, Southside Jamaica, Queens, Infinity Machine.
MC Southside Kid, wow. Cypher Sounds.
So you know, Baby J said, you know, I forgot about Woodside, and we also include this in the skating rings in the mix. So first of all, give it up for Baby J. He's here, came all the way from Pennsylvania. Tell us about the skating rings.
Well, actually, when I started, it was in the community center. Woodside Community Center, yes. From there, I was so, how can I say? I got into it, I got bit by the bug, and I went all out for it. And I've been doing this since 1973. I'm still active, I'm on the radio, I'm on TV, I produce, I do a lot of different things for my community, which is in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And Woodside Day is gonna be on July 14th, so everybody's invited. Getting back to the USA, I did everything that I had to do to get into the business, learn about it. I learned a lot from the big guys that were out, like, who used to throw the parties at St. Gage?
Jeff Harris.
Yeah. I gotta give a big shout out to him. He showed me a lot of stuff in the business, and I was only like 15. Ricky Grant, Kenneth Black. And then I used to run around with these guys. I was the only Latin guy. But I had a lot of soul. And I gotta give it up to everybody who used to go to USA, the roller rink. I opened up a lot of doors for a lot of groups there. I mean, I could keep on and keep on, but I wanna hear a lot of stuff from these brothers because I'm glad to see everybody. I'm glad to be here, New York City right now, man. And Ralph, I'm glad I hooked up with him because it's been great since we've been talking and everything like that. I've gotten to hook up with everybody.
Thank you for being here. Thank you. So I'm gonna bring up our guest host today, DJ Wiz, and I'm gonna give you a brief introduction of Wiz. We are partners now, and we work together with this video mix party, which as well as DJ Vern. But Wiz has a rich history right here in Elmhurst, in East Elmhurst, in this community right here, and he's gonna talk about the history of this area right here, as well as his musical history. And I want y'all to give it up for DJ Wiz and Kid Play. Yeah.
Brother Ralph, thank you, sir. Baby J. Baby J is definitely a legend. What's up, East Elmhurst, Corona? How y'all doing? You got the Bronx too. Well, be a Flushing. You see, she's been in Flushing longer than the Bronx. And all of these guys had an influence on me, including this man right here. But we're gonna go back even further. Earlier, we were showing some flyers up here on the screen. I hope everybody had a chance to briefly look at what was on the screen. But some of those flyers were for Cypher Sounds and Infinity Machine and Divine and all of these brothers right here. And some of the flyers were for Vern. Where's Vern? Oh, we didn't introduce Vern. All right, one more time for my brother, DJ Vern. That's another guy. The man who's playing the 45s. He's another major influence for me. Because when I was a little kid, growing up on 25th Avenue in East Elmhurst, right across the street from 127 Park, Vern was part of a crew, DJ Mobile Crew, called King Charles, who was like, they were the kings of this whole area, Queens. You know, and New Sounds as well. But it was their crew that played the music, spun the records, that had me run to the park to get influenced to become a DJ. We used to watch Vern and Charlie and Falk, all of y'all, just get on there and play like there were no real rap records out back then. There were no rap records. You know, we had just got introduced to rapping around that time. So, but it was because of guys like this. And I had a little crew in my neighborhood called the B-Boys. We were trying to learn how to do what they do. They had real equipment. Those turntables right there, the Technics turntables, we didn't have any of that. We were little kids who basically stole our parents' equipment. No, I swear to you, like, it sounds funny, but that's what we did. Our parents had these little plastic turntables. My dad might have got, I don't know if he got it from either Radio Shack or Corvettes or one of them stores. Like, I'm going old school when I say like Corvettes and Alexander's and all that stuff, because they used to sell everything. But it was a little Girard plastic turntable. Girard turntable. You know I ain't lying. The needles didn't really come off. Magnetic needles.
Bell driven?
No. It was a little rubber thing inside that.
It didn't have pitching.
Yeah, none of that. Baby J, you playing with me. All right. But long story short is I took my dad's turntable. Somebody else took their dad's mom's turntable. We put them together. We didn't have mixes back then. Like, we did not even deal with mixes. We dealt with the balance knob. We put one turntable into the one side of the balance and the other turntable into the other side of the balance, and that's how we DJ. We didn't have headphones. We just learned where the break was by sight. Everything that you see in that documentary, that movie on Netflix, The Get Down, we was doing that before that, way before that. But that's us. We would mark the record and just spin by sight, and that was it. So it's guys like this that influenced me to become a DJ and really just stay out of trouble. That's how we stayed out of trouble. We were in the house, learning how to DJ, learning how to rap. And that was at my friend Shaquem's house. His name is Anthony Ruff, but he was on 99th Street, right around the corner from me, right up the street from 25th Avenue. My boy Ronnie Tuff, Ron Lawrence, he's the one that gave us the flyers. He was part of that crew. And Ron, who's not here, Ron's in Florida. Ron's another East Elmhurst icon that was in the group with me then. And then he was in another group with me later when we became teens called the Turnout Brothers. And Kid from Kid and Play was also in that group with us. That was back in 81, 82. So we're taking it back, y'all. This is before all of the real blow up for hip hop. Before Run DMC, before LL, before all of this. We are part of this original foundation of making it pop here in Queens. Actually, okay now, cut that out. This is important information now.
Hey, cut that phone off, please.
Yeah, so back to goodness.
Come on, man.
You blowing up the spot, man. You on video too.
Take it outside. Take the phone
call
outside.
I'm trying to get JD here.
Come on, man.
I'm trying to get JD, but I can't do that.
So pardon the interruption, y'all, but seriously, the Turnout Brothers were very important to this area and to Queens in general, because we were like the first crew from Queens to actually get on the radio. There was a radio show called the World Famous Supreme Team, C Divine and Mastermind, Just a Lot of Superstar. They were on WHBI. They lived in our neighborhood. They lived right in East Elmhurst on Humphrey Street. So we got to meet them. Law's professor in the building, y'all. But we got to meet them. They knew we was hot. They put us on their show. They actually recorded us and played us on their radio show. And from that, we started doing gigs around the city with them. This is before records. This is before all of that. They put us on their show, and they also put Dr. Rock and the Force MCs from Staten Island on this show. So between us two, we were like doing our thing around the city. We were the first guys in Queens. Dr. Rock and the Force were the first from Staten Island, before Wu-Tang, before they were influencers for Wu-Tang, you know? So there's a lot of moving parts in this thing called hip hop that people just didn't know, you know? And even Flushing. There was other crews in Flushing. On that flyer, there was a crew called Rock and Rob. Yeah, Rock and Rob, Bamboo, MC Bamboo, all of them. Like, we did gigs with them, Paulie. Like, the Turnout Brothers, we were all right there in Flushing High. Right in Flushing High. Yep. It's like the sounds. You know? So, yeah. And that segue is perfect, because now I can hand it over to my brother from Flushing. One of my brothers from Flushing. The legendary DRES of Blacksheep. Give it up for him.
What up, y'all?
Yo, what's up?
Just want to give a salute to every single person right here, man, and everybody out here, man. Like, these are like legendary mythological creatures to me. You know what I'm saying? Because I was just under a shorty when they was doing what they was doing. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, I'm quick preface. My parents are from the fourth and fifth building in the Bland. They met, they both lived in different buildings. You know, typical project love story, they met, and they, it's the third or fourth building, but nonetheless, the year I was born, we got an apartment in Astoria Projects. So I'm from the Bland Projects and Astoria Projects wholeheartedly. You know what I'm saying? My parents are from third, fourth building. The year I was born, we got an apartment in Astoria Projects. So like I'm saying, me growing up until I moved to North Carolina for high school was me hearing about these cats, was me hearing about things that's going on in the park, or me even making my way to a park jam as a youngster, or visiting from Carolina and looking at cats and not even knowing who they are, but just amazed. You know what I'm saying? Just a shorty, and where's it around the head? This is before hip hop. This is cats just playing music and the park full and just rocking, you know what I'm saying? And I was hearing about, you know, like the Twins and, you know, like just different crews, you know what I'm saying? From all over, especially the story with the Twins and whatnot. And then I started getting older, and I would make my way as a shorty to an encore, or, you know what I'm saying, or whatever was going on around me when I'm visiting, you know what I'm saying? So I'm hearing about all of these cats just coming up, and it was mythological to me, because it was like, it's not like today where you would have a picture of someone, or you have a recording of someone. Either you was there or you wasn't, you know what I'm saying? And so for most of it, I wasn't there, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was literally a shorty that was just hearing about punk jams. And like, you know, we were singing like Rob, Rock and Rob. Like, that's my man. We like, and I'm giving you a little bit of dirt, you know, like we used to hustle together, you know what I'm saying? You know, I ain't the pavilion, no doubt. You know what I'm saying? And I remember being on the corner writing rhymes, because like I grew up kind of in hip hop, but just not known as far as ability. It was just out of love, just out of love of hearing, you know, beats being chopped up and learning how to DJ on my own. My cousin had equipment, so I started learning how to DJ. To go on years later to, you know, Blacksheep used to have a weekly night at this club called Mars in hip hop. I mean, in the city as DJs. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, it literally, you know, got to the point where I was familiar with a turntable, and literally, like, I remember my senior year of high school, and this is in Carolina, like, the need to be affiliated with hip-hop was so deep and so sincere that every single day after school, I would go to my man's crib who had equipment, and we would just cut and make tapes for each other. There was no one to send it to. There was no one that was even going to listen to it but us. But if you do everything for every day for a year or more, you become nice at it. So these were like the beginning stages of me being an MC. These were the beginning stages of me being able to DJ. Me having a knowledge of Cerrone's Big Beat to, you know, I mean, you know, whatever breaks were around me and available to me, I'm now touching them, you know what I'm saying? And now all of the stories that I'm hearing are like, it's starting to make sense to me, you know what I'm saying? Like, I wasn't the quintessential B-boy, whereas, you know, like, I come from some real street parents, real street family.
And they probably did everything they could to keep me out of the park. You know what I'm saying? So it was me sneaking, it was me finding, it was me growing up and meeting cats. That was my entry. And the first rhymes I was that was really me being heard by anyone was me hustling on Prince and Roosevelt. You know what I'm saying? Selling weed and saying rhymes to the cats I'm hustling with. That they're like, yo, you nice. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? Oh man, I mean, I wish I remembered one. But just saying. But